I was notified that the kids are going to be practicing for the Christmas concert here during worship. So if you want to come up, I believe you're going to head back there, and they'll be there to meet you and figure out what's going on there. So all the kids, you can head on back now, and we're ready to put some
above. See. Thank you.
Jesus, we're just reminded and thankful this holiday season, God, that you have come and brought us joy and life eternal, God. We thank you that we can just lay our worship at your feet and adore you, the Prince of Peace and King of Kings. There's no reason for this season but you, Jesus. And we just thank you as we go in and get deeper and deeper into the holiday spirits, God, that you just go before us and we just lay the crown at your feet, and that you're just the King over our lives, God. And that because of that, we can just spread the joy and the goodness of who you are. So we thank you this morning for everything that you are, everything that you've given us. And we thank you that we can give everything we can back. And we just praise your name today, Father. We adore you. We adore the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You are the Prince of Peace. Let our adoration go on our lips, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you for meeting us here. We love you. For worshiping with us, you may be seated.
So, got a few announcements for you. Men's group, we meet 6:30 every Wednesday here, right below where we eat at. 6:30 every Wednesday. I'd like to see as many people there as we can. Women's group is starting this week. That's 6 p.m. Thursday, so the day after. And you can just meet right here. I don't know where they'll take you from there. We have, let's see, prayer. This is a big one. If you're going to listen to one thing I say up here, listen to this. We have prayer at 9 a.m. every Saturday. So far, it is just me and Mike. We'd like to see you there. Prayer, 9 a.m. Saturdays. Alberto, you want to bless the offering for us?
Oh, sure. All right. Dear Lord, thank you so much for having us here today. We're just so blessed to gather to praise you, and we are just so honored, and I'm just so glad to be a part of this church. Can't wait to see it grow, and as we all listen today to the message given, that we all have ears to hear, and Lord, we just bless you, and let us just be fruitful givers today, and we're just excited to see your kingdom grow. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. So as they go through, they're going to take the offering and they're going to hand you a piece of paper. On one side of that piece of paper, it's going to have a number. We've been talking about missions. We've been talking about giving to missions over the last couple of weeks. We're going to continue that trend today. And I just want you to hold on to this. We'll talk about it in a little bit. Couple more announcements, though, while they're doing that. Saturday, the 18th at 10 a.m., so that's not this coming, but the following Saturday, there is a cookie baking and bring your gifts to wrap. So that's going to be not this coming, but the following Saturday. And then not this coming, but the following Sunday, we do have a kids' concert and cookie decorating after. So that'll be during church, though. Next week, I want to talk a little bit about that. We have our missionary coming to speak. And to follow that, we will have kind of a catered meal afterwards. We'll call it like a banquet. Maybe it's not that fancy, but We will have it catered, and we invite you all to stay, and the missionary will join us for that, and you'll get to know him a little bit. So before I start my message, we have a small video clip we're going to play. If Mike can figure it out.
Let's go, Mike!
Man, Lord, we gotta understand. We're on a mission from God.
I just watched the movie a week ago.
Yeah?
Blues Brothers, 1980.
That's right.
And Ecuador John Belushi.
All right, let's pray before I get started and tell you why I showed you that. God, we just thank you that we can come today, that we can give, Lord, that we can bless your name and just praise you with our song, Lord. We pray that you would pierce our hearts with a message today that's relevant to all of us, and we pray that we would have good fellowship afterwards and get to enjoy each other's company. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your name we pray.
Amen.
So like the Blues Brothers said, and Matthias repeated, we are on a mission from God. The goal of my message today is to hopefully show you that while, yes, it is important for us to support missions, which that card is about, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, it's just as important for you to live your life on mission. Just as important. One of Jesus' last actions was giving the Great Commission. A lot of you have probably heard that term before. And basically, it's instruction to all believers on what to do when he leaves. And we find that in Matthew 28:19. I don't have slides for you today. I apologize. I forgot. I know I'm going to hear about that from Richard later. Matthew 28:19. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. There's a couple of things I want to look at today with this scripture. And to do this, we need a little bit of an English refresher, if you don't remember from grade school days. Basically, there's two verbs I want to focus in on with this scripture, okay? Now, a verb is an action, state, or occurrence. Action, state, or occurrence. And the first one I want to look at is the word go. He said, go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations. This one's actually a little controversial, believe it or not. This translation is very debated among translators and scholars. Some say that it reads correctly as go in this translation I read you right here, while others say it should read as you go. As you go. They say that's a more accurate translation. And while those seem like really subtle differences, it kind of is a big deal. And if we take a look at it, if we look at just go, and we take that scripture as that, it's an action, right? It means to go out, to move, to leave. And it's easy to get the notion that to now fulfill what's about to be said, you have to leave where you're at. You have to leave kind of who you are. And it's easy for a Christian to think, basically, I have to become a missionary to fulfill this scripture. And if you have that view, it's probably really easy to be overwhelmed by that and kind of give up and just think, well, I'm not a missionary. I can't do it then. And we leave that scripture alone. And in doing that, we kind of just, throw the whole thing out, right? So if you reason yourself with that and you're not a missionary, I can see why that would be difficult. So let's look at it a little bit differently. Let's look at this scripture if it was translated the other way that some people say it should be, as you go. So, therefore, as you go, make disciples of all nations. As you go suggests that you're working to accomplish this goal of creating disciples while living out your everyday life. Just day-to-day actions. And it kind of gets rid of that excuse of, oh, I have to be a missionary to do this, doesn't it? It means while you're at home, while you're at the gym, while you're at work, while you're at the store, while you're at the post office, Sam. We have a mailman in the midst of people. It means that you're doing this all the time. You're spreading the gospel. You're sharing the love of Jesus Christ that you have and that you're fortunate enough to have heard about. You're sharing that with the people around you. In other words, you're to live your life as that of a missionary right where you're at and spread the gospel that way. That's a way different version, isn't it? Kind of thought-provoking, though, if you look at it like that. But as important as that verb is to this verse, it is not the main verb in the sentence. If you remember English class, there's a main verb. That's not it. The main verb here is make. I'm going to read it to you again. As you go, therefore make disciples of all the nations. Make. Specifically that making disciples. Of all nations. To put that into more understanding terms, he's saying to make followers of Christ out of all types of people, all types of races, culture and background, anything like that, even their current religion, goes out the window with this statement. Any notion of you have to be a certain way to be preached to or to be reached, it's done. He says, go reach everybody. That was significant in those times because at that time they were only preaching to the Jews. That wouldn't have included most of us, right? But Jesus opened that door up for everybody. Notice he didn't say, though, he said to create disciples. What he didn't say was go out and get as many people to follow you and be led in this certain prayer, right? We say the prayer of salvation. He didn't say go get people to pray this prayer. He didn't say go get a mass amount of people to convert at an altar or something like that. Now, those are starts. But what he's prescribing we do here is much more serious than that, and it's a much weightier task. It's a lot harder. It's a lot more difficult, really. He's saying to make disciples. That's not something that you can do in one conversation. That's not something that we can do in a passing by. That's something that takes time. It takes effort on our part and on theirs. He's talking about living out your faith in front of these people and instructing them in the ways of the Lord until they can stand on their own two spiritual feet. And then they would then reproduce that, right, with somebody else and teach them. That's what he's talking about here. Somewhere I think the church as a whole has kind of digressed into thinking we sit down with people, we get them to pray a prayer, maybe we even baptize them, and that's it. We're off the hook after that. We did our job. He never said that, though. That's not how he instructed us to do it. It's a lot deeper than that, and it's something that we're called to do. So what I hope that you're gathering from all of this is that whether you're a full-time missionary, which I don't think anyone sitting in the room right now is, or you're just a regular 9-to-5 worker, or you're a student, no matter who you are, even if you still live in your hometown where you're born and raised, either way, you are called to partake in this great commission that Christ gave us. Do you know it's interesting? I've heard a lot of times that reaching the lost is for pastors here, and it's for missionaries there. So when we talk about this great commission, people say that that's missionary work. You know how many times the word missionary is mentioned in the Bible? None. The word is not in the Bible. It's a word that we developed later to describe what he's talking about here. But Jesus never had a specific word set aside for people that would go out and do that. And do you know why? It's because it's all of our responsibility. It's supposed to be a lifestyle, not a small group of people. It's for all Christians. We see him give this command again, actually. Acts 1, verse 8. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be, listen to this part, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Now, when I read that, Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, end of the earth, you may not get a lot from that. You may see that and not really know where those places are, not really have an understanding of why did he list those places specifically. So I want to break this down. I want to really unpack this scripture and show you why Jesus was so specific with listing those four places that he did. Because a lot of times people just take that last one, ends of the earth. It means, okay, go reach everybody. But he was being really specific here, and he did it for a reason. So let's put each place into context of why he said this to the disciples. First, he said Jerusalem. Go to Jerusalem, right? So in the context of who he's talking to, which is his disciples, he said, go to Jerusalem. Well, guess what? When he said that, they were already in Jerusalem. He told them this in Jerusalem. So they're already there, right? It's a place that they're comfortable with. It's a place that they have been around their entire lives. It's really supporting the notion, though, of what we've been talking about, preaching where you're at. Even though he said go there, they were already there. He's telling you to go to the people around you, right? He's telling them to preach right where they're at. And I think it's worth noting here, too, that when we talk about, you know, preaching at the people right where you're at, he's talking about close people, right? When he's talking about Jerusalem, your Jerusalem, right? Your Jerusalem is your friends, your family, people that you are deeply involved with on a regular basis. That's your Jerusalem. That's who Jesus is calling you to in that sense. And it's also worth saying, it doesn't matter if you like these people or not. We have family, we have people that used to be close friends maybe that we don't really like, right? Or we think, oh, they're never going to change. It's no use sharing my faith with them. They're stuck in their ways. When Jesus told them to go preach to those in Jerusalem, this was days after the people of Jerusalem shouted, crucify him, wanted him killed on a cross. And he said, go preach to these people. Now, I don't think you know anybody that's done something that wrong to you. Don't rule them out. Next, he says Judea. Judea, to the guys that he's talking to, was kind of where they grew up. It's the general area, right, where the Jews live, part of that country. Jesus was referring here to people that they're familiar with, people like them, people with the same culture, maybe the same moral values. They're going to be really relatable people to them. Think about, what's your Judea? A lot of you live here in the harbor, some of you live in Zion, stuff like that. The people you see on a regular basis, the people that you look around and you're like, yeah, I'm kind of like them. Maybe you have the same political views. Maybe your kids go to the same school. You have a similar, like, work life, financial status, stuff like that. That's what he's talking about with your Judea. The type of people that maybe you're friends with on Facebook, but you don't have interactions with them all the time. And a lot of you don't even say hi to them if you see them in the store. I know it's you. That always got me. Friends with people on Facebook, they see it, don't act like they don't. But that's your Judea, right? It's people, yeah, maybe they're like you, but you're not super close with them. And that's okay. But that's who he's talking about. That's part of your ministry. Think about this. You see these people on a regular basis, right? Or semi-regular. You know who they are. But do you know where they're at with Jesus? Do you know where they're at with the Lord? If they're believers? If they love Jesus? If they died right now, if they'd go to heaven or not? Or flip the page, kind of, do they know where you're at? Have you ever shared with them that? They should. If you're a true believer and walking your life out with Christ, they should. He moves on from there and he says, go to Samaria. Now, this is where it starts to get uncomfortable for these guys he's talking to, and it may get uncomfortable for you. Samaria, if you're not kind of familiar with it, it's where present-day Palestine was. It was a place where generations earlier, the Jews, it was still Jews, right? It was part of the promised land. But when other societies had come in and ruled the Jews for periods of time, these Jews decided we're not going to hold on to our beliefs and our culture as much. We'll kind of let them come in. And what had happened is this group that they would then call Samaritans was basically a mixed bag. It was all these other cultures mixing in with the Jews, kind of making their own. They still believed in one true God of Israel. But they wavered. They took in these other false gods too, pagan gods. So their culture was much different than that of like Judea, what Jesus was talking about before. So as a result of that, Jews that were true Jews, right, not mixed in with other religions and that, they wanted nothing to do with these people. They literally wouldn't even talk to them if they were around them. They looked at them as a much lesser people than they were. And if we're being honest, right? We all have that. we all have certain sects of life, right? Certain cultures, or maybe like different ways people dress, or their crowd. Think of it in high school. You have like your athletic crew, you might have like a gothic crew, you might have this or that or whatever. We have ones that we don't really prefer, if we're being honest, right? Maybe it's political. Maybe you have certain political groups you don't like. They're not like you. We don't have the same values. We don't have the same morals. We don't have the same culture. We don't look at the world the same way. That's what he's talking about here when he's talking about the Samaritans. But guess what? He included them in this list. He included your Samaria, whoever that is, and I don't want you to say it out loud, because I don't want it to get dicey in here. But whoever that is, he called you to them too. He called the disciples them too. He didn't close the door just because you don't like them. My point is all of that is this. With the Samaritans in it. Just because people are different than you doesn't mean Christ didn't die for them. Because he did. You're still supposed to tell them about Jesus. You're still supposed to invite them to church. And when you have opportunities to do that, and you pass, that's only wrong on your part. That's sin in your life, not theirs. All we can do is give them an opportunity, right? So now we've gotten through three of these four places. We're 75% of the way through. And I hope you've gathered at this point that you can do this. You can minister to these people right where you're at in life. You don't have to move. You don't have to change jobs. You don't have to go across the world. You can fulfill all these parts right here, right where you're at. Thank God he made it simple for us, right? Thank God he made it simple, but we complicate it. But it does leave us one. Last I checked, 75% is still a C. I know that because I got a lot of this. But we don't want that. Right? We want to go for that 100%. So the last one he mentions is the ends of the earth. Now, how in the world do we accomplish that? How do we accomplish reaching the ends of the earth? I got news for you. God didn't call everybody to be a foreign missionary. And if you read that scripture like that, again, it'll overwhelm you, and you'll probably just not even attempt it. That's okay. A lot of you in this room, he didn't call to be a foreign missionary. Now, maybe some he did. But so how do we partake in this? How do we fulfill this great commission and this what we see in Acts 1:8 when all we have is the world around us, right? And that's where that card comes in when I got you. Everybody grab your card. I think we all got one. Families at least all got one. And this is what I've been telling you. And you can all be my witnesses. I have never asked any of you people for money through this church. We take an offering. I've never even told you, hey, you need to be tithing, you need to this or that, and no one in here could say otherwise. But this portion right here is different. This is money that we want to raise as a church family for missionaries. What that means is whatever we decide to give to them, not a dime of it goes into this church, not a dime of it is shipping and handling, nothing like that. This goes 100% into missionaries' pocketbooks. Now, what do they do with that? I want to build the value for you with what these people do with that. I sat down with a missionary this week on Thursday, I think it was, and I spent 5 hours with this guy, digging into where does our money go, what do we do, talking to him about his theology, what are you teaching these people? And the bottom line is this. They use this money to spread the gospel. The Assemblies of God is the missionaries that we'll work with because they, for lack of a better reason, we know they're efficient. They've had to go through a long process where we know that they're doing what they're saying they're doing. I mean, we don't have boots on the ground there, right? So it's tough to see where this money really goes. These people, they check in on them. And we just know that it's good soil, right? And we want our money to go to a good thing. They say that it's an average, and I'll have the exact statistic for you next week, but it's an average of like $110 that's sent to Assemblies of God missionaries is how much it costs, on average, to see one person come to Christ in a foreign country. $110. That's not that much, I don't think. It cost us about $20,000 to build the church, to get this church started here in America, which is about a tenth of what they normally say it costs to get a church going. And we've seen four or five people come to Christ. I can assure you that math doesn't equal out to $110. So we know that this money is going to be used well. So what we ask with this card is that next week when we come in, and don't use this as a reason not to come next week, hopefully the weather will be a little nicer. You guys are the real people. A lot of people stayed home because it was hailing or whatever it was. So applaud yourself.
Yeah,
applaud, yeah, you came with that. So applaud yourself. But seriously, guys, this is an opportunity. If we read this scripture and we believe the Bible, and I'm assuming you do to an extent because you're here, and we're preaching Bible every week, we're preaching Jesus, we have to fulfill what he said to do. Our way to do that is to give to missions. And I'm not here to tell you how much. I know that there's people that have asked me, hey, can I give $5 a month? Would that matter? Yes, it would matter. Yes, it would matter. I know people personally who give $30,000 a year to missions. You're not going to get that from me. I'm not going to be able to boost us up like that. But I'm just saying, no, nothing's too small. Nothing's too big. What I want you to do with this card this week is I want you to take it. I want you to hold on to it. I want you to put it in your wallet or your purse. And I want you to really pray about it and ask God, what should I give? If he tells you nothing, then give nothing. I don't think you will. I can't stress to you enough how important this is. We can only do what we can do here with the people around us. And my message to you today obviously focused on that. But these people overseas, they don't have the luxury. Anybody in America can go hear the gospel if they want to. You can find a church in just about every town, if not the town next to you has it. Some kind of church. Bibles are everywhere. You can't stay in a hotel without seeing one in the drawer, right? You can hear the gospel here if you want to. These countries like Haiti that we will support, places in Africa, missionaries in Iran, they're not even supposed to be there. And if they find out they're there, they will kill them. But we have people there that will support. That's where we need to put money. That's where we need to sow seed, right? And so I'm asking you today that as we come in here next week and we listen to a missionary firsthand, that you would just consider giving to this. People will literally be in heaven because of the money given here today or next week or whatever. Literally will be in heaven. Think about that. That's not a light thing. That's a really weighty thing. And we can't blow past it. Josh, if you want to come up, I asked him to close us in a song today. I was debating on telling you. So next week, our parent church has about 60 people. And they did their missions thing 2 weeks ago. How much money do you think for 1 year, a church of 60 people raised? Any guesses?
$50,000.
$50,000, okay. What was the other one?
I'd say about maybe $12,000.
$12,000. This group of 60, maybe 65 people, just raised $84,000 to send a mission. Well, I told you, it is a lot of money. That's something to be proud of. These aren't wealthy people by any means either. I told them that this church is going to raise $10,000. And I believe that with my whole heart. I don't know how we're going to do it, and I was debating telling you that, but we're going to, and I just want you guys to be a part of that. So as Josh closes us in a song, all I will ask is that you just keep this in prayer through the week. And I hope that you'll stay. What do we have today?
Tacos.
We have tacos after church downstairs. So I ask that you guys would stay with us, hang out a little bit, talk about this. If you have any questions about this, ask me. Ask Alberto, ask Casey, ask Mike, guys that we've really dug into this and they kind of have a good understanding of it. So God bless you guys. He's going to close the song and I'm going to see you downstairs.
All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher in my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. Joining us. Have a wonderful day. Join us downstairs for some food, fellowship, and yeah.